gonna please turn your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 7. We're going to read from verse 15 to 23. Matthew 7, 15 to 23. For those of us who've been coming to the morning service, just last week we started a series. This one is entitled God's Will. We're looking at what God's will is concerning us. And I think as children of God, it's very important to us that we know and understand His will concerning us. I was saying last week that if we've ever wondered whether God has a prayer request, we will soon find out what the Lord Jesus' prayer request is. And that's what we're looking and the intention is for us to look at. So last week, as you know, that the DVDs and CDs are available, but I'll give you a little recap. We looked up what it means. A will is a wish or a desire, an intention, a longing for, a yearning, a craving, a want, a request, or a command. These are what the English word will is. And so we're looking at what is it that God desires of us? What is God's intention when He created us? What is it that God longs for? The Bible said that the Lord God spoke and said, "Oh Israel, how I long to gather you like the hen gathers her chicks." So it's God's longing to gather us as a people to bring us to Himself. What's His longing? What does He yearn for? What does He crave for? What is it that His request? If we were to ask God, what is your prayer request? What is it that He would say to us? And last week we looked at Mark chapter 3, where it gives an account of how the Lord Jesus was preaching, the crowd pressed in on Him and all of that. And as He was preaching and teaching, the scripture tells us clearly that they told Him, "Your mother and your brothers are outside." And then the Lord Jesus responds and says, "Who are my mother, my brothers?" He asks. Then He looks at them sitting and says, whoever, that means any single body, anybody who does God's will is my brother and my sister. And I know that Jesus is our Lord and He's our benchmark. And if anything, I would want, my desire. You know, there's a scripture that talks about when the Lord Jesus was baptized. We read a scripture about how the Lord Jesus was baptized. The Bible said that when He was baptized, the heavens opened, the Spirit of God descended like a dove. And then there was an audible voice of God which said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Listen to Him." I'm sure, well, certainly that's my prayer. My desire is that God will say concerning me, "This is my beloved daughter in whom I'm well pleased." Wouldn't you like that? Or is it just me? That's my desire. If that's our desire, then we need to look at the scriptures and see what He has concerning us. Therefore, let's look at Matthew chapter 7 as we continue with this from verse 15 to 23. This is the Lord Jesus speaking. "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them." Verse 21. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" Amen. This is one of the scriptures. I don't know about you, but there's certain times when I read the Bible, I kind of get a bit scared. And this is one of the scriptures that scare me. And I know that before I used to be scared of Revelation. If you're scared of Revelation, I can see some of you nodding. I used to be as well, but it's a very interesting, good book. Don't be afraid. Go and read it. But this scripture actually terrifies me and scares me, because this is Jesus speaking to you and I, and we're talking about God's will. When you go home, like I always say, go and read the whole of Matthew chapter 7. You realize there's like all the Sermon on the Mount, as the Lord Jesus sat and began to teach the people, the crowd that were following Him. But He starts this particular discourse by telling them, "Watch out." If I say to you, "Watch out," what does that tell you? The word "watch out" itself is a warning. It means pay particular attention to what I'm about to tell you. He says, "Watch out for false prophets." He tells us that they come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. Now, when you read that thing, it talks about false prophets. Obviously, we know who prophets are. We know about the people that prophesy on behalf of God. We know that at that particular time and during the time, I know that some of you, I'm always telling you all that I don't believe in good old days. That's just me personally. If you believe in it, that's okay. But, you hear people always saying, oh, in those days, in those days, we used to do this and we used to do that. As far as I'm concerned, human nature is human nature and sin is sin. So when we look back to those idyllic days in the 1960s or 1800s or whatever, you'll find that in those days, there were loads of people committing lots of atrocious crimes. People were being raped. There were loads of people who had all those kings that had loads of mistresses. They lived anyhow. In the Greek times, most of them were, all the emperors were homosexuals. They would sacrifice human beings to idols. So there were deep times. So in the biblical days, those times were deep times. And during those deep times, you would find that there were loads of false prophets. When you read all the Old Testament, you will find that a lot of the time God will be warning the prophets, you're not talking on my behalf. Don't listen to these people. Don't listen to that. So in that time, there were also false prophets. The same time as now, in this particular time, there are false prophets. We've been told, I think we've all heard, that we're in a season where people are prophesying, and Pastor Chichi was referring to it, and she was she said she was being kind. Where people come and prophesy, say, you're wearing this particular underwear, this and that, and that. They're diviners, and people are going around seeking all these prophets. So God is telling us now, if this word is relevant to you and I now, that we should watch out for false prophets. The Bible says we should test every spirit. And so we thank God that not in this house, amen. We're not going seeking after those prophets who are going to tell us our date of birth. Why? Do you not know your date of birth? Do you not believe your mother? When your mother told you that you were born on the same day as the Lord Jesus Christ, 27th of September? You can fight for yourself. Jesus and I, twinies, we're twins. You were not there when you were born, but your mother told you that this is your birthday. You don't need somebody else to come and tell you that you were born on that particular day. Neither do you need somebody to come and give you your passport number. Your passport is your passport. You don't need me to come and tell you. So we don't need to be seeking after that. We thank God that we have been blessed in this house with the true prophet of God who speaks as it were the very oracles of God. And so I want to encourage each one of us and warn us at the same time that let's not get... what do you call it? Let's not be deceived. Let's not get entrapped in that worm. Let's not into that web that we're going seeking here and there. We seek him here, we seek him there. No, for God is right here in this very house. So watch out for the false prophets. In the same vein, God is also telling us, watch out for false teachings. Yes, the prophet, the one that will declare. The prophecy is basically speaking the counsel and mind of God. And so somebody that teaches, many a time people teach wrong doctrine. People teach doctrine that is not biblical, it's not based on the word of God. You might be talking to somebody, it could be your friend, it could be anybody, it could be a pastor, that's why it's very important that we pray for our pastors. I want to encourage everybody, because if you're going to go astray, guess who's going to take you there? Your papa. Because if he's got a doctrine which is false, which is why we have things like, I saw on WhatsApp the video of some man who told his congregation to go and eat grass. Anybody see that? And they're eating the grass. Now you and I can sit back and say, what's wrong with them? Blah, blah, blah. But you see, that's doctrine. That's how they believe, because they believe in the person that's over them. That's why it is important for you and I to watch out for these things and to pray for the one who's over us, the gift that God has given us, so that he will hear and hear aright and direct you aright. Because if you need to get to heaven, it is important that he is in counsel, good counsel with God. Let me hear somebody say amen. So those kind of teachings and doctrines that seep in. Sometimes there's new ageism and all manner of things. You might be talking to your friend. It may sound good. It may be, sometimes it's not even a teacher. It's not even a pastor. But somebody that you share with. But that we need to get to the place where our spirit man is so trained and developed that we will be able to pick up. Last week we talked about that maturity. Just like the Bible said that we should eat and chew bones. Just like when you eat fish, who eats fish and swallows the bones? Who does that? Nobody does that. You eat the fish and you separate the meat from the bones. If you swallow a bone, it was by accident, and you pray and believe God that it doesn't affect you anyway. You have the ability to be able to separate the meat from the bones. And I will release that unction in this house in the name of Jesus. That each one of us will get to that point, maturity. The Bible says that like newborn babes, we should desire the sincere milk of the word so that we may what? Grow in that way. Remember when we did growth? That is infused in us. God requires of us to grow. So in that growth, God is telling you and I, as Freedom Center International, we're talking about God's will. Let's not lose it. He says, watch out for that false prophet. Watch out. That means that you have to be, to watch means that you have to be able to be attentive. You have to be able to observe. You have to be able to understand that it's very possible that what somebody is telling you might not necessarily be right. It also means that you have to train yourself. We need to discipline ourselves in the things of the Lord. He tells us that they come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. God is telling you and I that it's difficult sometimes to be able to see. That is why I need the Lord, and that is why you need the Lord. Without God, there is nothing that we can do. We cannot do anything. We cannot see. Sometimes people come to you, they will be smiling with them. I'm not here to give you what you call suspicious theories. Don't live in a suspicious world. But know and understand, just like God is telling us, that we need to keep an eye out. We need to make sure that our antennas are right. Watch out for those false prophets. Watch out. Be attentive. He says, they come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. Just like the scripture says, sometimes the devil comes in an angel of light, not in the way that you expect him to come. Because if we know that, this particular way, this one is the devil, then, you know, the devil's work is, he's working in vain. But remember what I always say, he's a bad devil. He's professional what he does. And so he's like a, what's that word, animal called, chameleon. He can change his colors. He can adapt to the environment in which he's in. That is why we must watch and pray in prayer. Because they come like a sheep. Remember, God refers to us as sheep. For God is what? Our shepherd. Who is he to us? He's our shepherd. That's why the scripture tells us he's the good shepherd. He is the only one that can shepherd us. He said, I'm the good shepherd. I know how to look out for my sheep. And then he says, my sheep hear my voice. And no stranger's voice do they hear. I pray in the name of Jesus, when God comes to you, that you will hear and hear him clearly. No other stranger's voice will you hear. Some of us were listening to strangers' voices. It's time for us to block. Do you understand? You know, sometimes we have selective hearing. Remember, I was giving you an analogy of my son. When you're telling him something, he said, pardon? Pardon? It's not that hasn't heard it, but it may be that what you're telling him to do, he doesn't necessarily want to do it. So he might say, pardon? That's called selective hearing. But sometimes when we're relating to God, we have selective hearing. So God may say to us, get up today and bring an offering. Because that offering you don't want to give, it becomes what? Selective hearing. So you'll be like, oh, I think, get thee behind me, Satan. I don't think that God will ask me to do this, that, or the other. But when God says something to you that you love, you just say, amen, praise the Lord. The person's not here, so I'll give a little thing. I was talking to somebody, and the Lord gave me a word for the person. And as I relayed the word, the person said to me, that's a good word. Because I had a dream, and it confirmed exactly what had happened. So I said, oh, praise the Lord. And I continued in the release of the prophetic word. The next bit, the person didn't like. He said, oh, no, I don't think so. That's in the same vein, the same conversation, right? Pashugun was there. It was the same conversation. As I started to say, the Lord said this, that, the other, she said, amen, amen. Then she said to me, you know, you heard right. That's a confirmation, because yesterday I had a dream. And of course, you know, I was like, oh, praise the Lord, I was continuing. And the next bit, she said, no. That's how sometimes we deal with God. What suits us, we take. And what doesn't suit us, we just bypass it. But that's not how God wants to deal with us. And that's not how he deals with you and I. Amen. He's a good and a faithful God. He's our good shepherd who knows how to look after his sheep. Some years ago, we did a series on I Am. Those of you who were here, if you're not here, get this tape. Wonderful series. It blessed me so much. When we started to look about the shepherd and how he looked after his sheep. And also he's referred to as the gateway, right? About how he lies by the entrance to the sheep pen to make sure that nobody, no thief, nobody comes to get the sheep. That's what a shepherd does at his own risk. And that's your portion in Jesus' name. Because they come like in sheep's clothing. So just like God has called us to be sheep, that means that sometimes the devil comes just like one of us. Just like us, just like the chameleon. And that is why Jude writes and says that for them, some who have crept in unawares. But in this house, it's good for people creeping unawares in a way, because he must keep us on our toes. But those that have crept in unawares, if they don't change or repent, guess what? Out of the door. Because we refuse them entry in this house. We refuse them entry in this house. In the same manner, you should refuse them entry into your house, because they come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's what the thief comes to do. Because he comes just like you and I. They're praising the Lord just like you and I. Sometimes we're led to believe that if somebody is not born again, they cannot mention the name Jesus. You know, we hear that. That's a lie of the enemy. I remember when I was a teenager, I used to watch loads of horror films. Why, I don't know. I don't want to encourage you to do that. But I watch these horror films and I'll just be all cooped up. They used to have this thing called Hammer House of Horror. Yeah, Carol? I used to watch them back to back and I'll just be there like that. And in the night when I first went, oh! Anyway, so I used to watch these Hammer House. And these horror films, you would find that when the vampires come, the vampires used to be afraid of what? Garlic and the cross. You see that? And so when the vampire comes and you just go, and the vampire just goes, and then we're going back. Well, you're watching films like that and you think to yourself that if I just bring out a cross and go like, or that person cannot mention Jesus. No, that's a film. Do you understand what I mean to you? So we think that because that person says in Jesus' name, or says Jesus, or comes to the house, or comes into the altar, that means that they're born again. I'm not here to bring a suspicious thing, but to give you the word. We're still talking about God's will, that we should watch out. Because they come, they sneak in unawares. It says, inwardly, they are ferocious wolves. What is the relation of a wolf to a sheep? A wolf to the sheep. Let me put it this way. I was going to say they're enemies, but let me put it this way. The wolf is an enemy to the sheep. Because the wolf's job is to eat the sheep. A wolf, when the wolf sees a sheep, it will eat it. But not only does the wolf eat a sheep, it devours the sheep. In fact, well, you know, good old Dr. Google, I just double-checked the relationship between the sheep and the wolf. And I found out that at a particular incident, two wolves were able to devour 200 sheep. Two against 200. When they went, those two wolves had killed 200 sheep. I mean, look at that comparison. And God is using that same analogy for you and I. So as church, we need to sit up. Ephesians says, wake up, O sleeper. I love that scripture. Then he doesn't finish Elder Patrick. Wakey, wakey. But he says, rise from your sleep. No, he says, rise from the dead. Rise from the dead. Our God lives. Amen. So we have to emulate that life that he's given us. It's time for us to rise from the dead. But inwardly, they are ferocious wolves. That's why he uses the adjective to describe it. Because they will get you. They're out to yam you. And that is why we thank God for the power. Pastor Chichi told us about the power, the authority that we have. It's not about us just saying it. I'm sick and tired of it. I don't want to just say, oh, you know, God, I have power. Where is the power? Hello? It's about the demonstration of God's power. And this is now our season for that. For Paul said to Corinthians, he said, for I come to you, not with enticing words of men. That's what he said. I come to you. And Paul was very learned. And that's why I think he said that. He said he was learned. He was under, wasn't it, Galileo, whatever his name is. He was very schooled. He was an intellectual, a scholar. So I suppose when he got there, people were thinking, oh my gosh, he's coming to give us the Greek, the Hebrew, blah, 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 blah. So they were getting lost under that. And he said, look, I come to you not with those enticing words of man, that knowledge, those flattery, that thing that I know you want to hear. You want to hear, hallelujah, eshando, sedede, praise the Lord. Yeah, yeah, it's good word. But sometimes you need to relax a little bit and hear well. Amen? And so I come to you not so that you can jump and shout and say, amen, hallelujah. But he says something. He says, I come to you not with enticement, but with the power and the demonstration of the gospel. Let there be a portion in the name of Jesus. As you go out there, let it not just be rhetoric. I pray that as you lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. When you declare a thing, it shall come to pass. When somebody comes against you and you say, this and this and this will not happen, guess what? God will honor the word that comes out of your mouth. The Bible said concerning Samuel, he said that no counsel of his fell to the ground. It means to say everything that Samuel said, the Lord just took it up. That is your portion in Jesus' name. Amen. And so he says, by their fruit, you will recognize them. What does the scripture say about the fruit? Galatians 5, don't turn there, 22-23 says this. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. By their fruit, you should know them. You would recognize them. Saints, God is telling you and I how to watch out, how to look out for these things. And amongst our also among concerning our own selves, are we bearing fruit? Because God is requiring of us that we must bear fruit. Sometimes when you look at somebody, you should be able to see evidently. As I keep telling you, Pastor and I have been in, for years now, we've been having this argument about whether in this world is about nature or nurture. We still haven't come to any conclusion. Every few days, every few months, we'll go back to it and say, what do you think? And I'll say, oh, I think it's nature. Oh, what do you think? It's nature. Oh, but I don't know. We keep going round and round. We haven't concluded it. Maybe you know the answer. Because sometimes you'll find that maybe somebody was born at birth. They were adopted. They don't have no clue about their mother, their father. Eventually, they're old, and then they discover their biological parents. And then they will find, oh, my gosh, I behave exactly like my father. Obviously, they were not brought up by their father, so it's got to be a nature thing, right? Or sometimes it's nurture as well. So you could train up a child in the way he should go. So if you take a child and decide, I'm going to train, that's why we need to train our children in this house, amen? For in this house, my desire and my prayers concerning myself that my children will always be found in the house of the Lord. Not only my children, but their children's children. I want to be known as, you see, Dorothy's descendants, they're Levites, they're in the house. And so should you. And that's why I was saying at the church workers seminar, I want to encourage everybody. What I found when I was looking in the Old Testament, I discovered, and when we were talking about Obed-Edom we've been looking at in the time in his God's presence, we realized that when the ark left Obed-Edom's house, his blessings were not cut short, you know. When you read the account, you would assume that because the ark was bringing that blessing, when it left, that was it. No, he continued to be blessed. And we realized that when he was blessed, he became a gatekeeper. He was a gatekeeper. His children were also what? Gatekeepers and all his descendants. So he brought up his children in the way of the Lord. And so that is our portion. But we must bear fruit. Physical fruit. Just like what I'm talking about physically, we must give birth to children. And so I'm here to prophesy to you that every womb in this house will bear child in the name of Jesus, as long as you desire it. I know that some people don't desire to have children. That's another thing. But if you desire, we refuse barrenness in this house. And I personally will not keep silent until I see the manifestation of that in Jesus' name. Every womb and every loin must produce. You want to receive it wherever you are. So we must produce children because after all, at the beginning, God told us, be fruitful, multiply, increase, replenish the earth. And you know, other faiths are producing on a regular basis. We need to produce physically and biologically. We must bring up our spiritual children. We must bear fruit. In the same way, as we bear fruit in discipling, as we bear fruit in bringing up our children in the house of the Lord and reproducing after our kind, in the same way, our characteristics should bear fruit. Our character should bear fruit. I'm always reminded of the scripture when it says that God made Adam in his image and his likeness. We are made in God's image, so we must look like God and do what? Behave like God. We must have God's character. And that's what God is telling us. By their fruit, you will recognize them. So God is telling each one of us that, do my will. My will is that you will bear fruit. My will is that you will be productive. And over these past few days, that's what we've been talking about. And Papa came and talked to us about productivity. God expects for us whatever God gives you. You understand? He expects productivity. We do realize that, don't we? God never expects to give us a gift and then at the end of the day just say, okay, what did you do with the gift? Well, I sang for myself. Well, I cooked for myself. Every gift that God gives, he expects a gift is for a blessing for other people. He expects for other people to be touched by your gift. He expects that you reproduce after that kind. That is why the Bible says your gift will make room for you. It will allow you to appear before men, men of stature, not in front of mere men. What God is telling you and I is that as you exhibit the gift, your connector out there will see you and bring you into, that's your portion. Somebody needs to receive it. In the name of Jesus, I prophesy that in this year 2014, as we spend time in God's presence, the doors will become automatic for you, that it will open for you, position you at the right place at the right time. Look at scripture. You know, I love to quote Esther. How is it? Think about it. How can the whole Queen Vashti, in a time where women were objects, stand before the king in front of his friends and say, I will not do what you want me to do? Because God was orchestrating for Esther to be promoted. That's your portion. Somebody needs to receive that in Jesus' name. How is it that when Ruth and Naomi go to Israel, of all the, what do you call it, the fields to glean, Elder Jerry, so many people, how is it that Ruth finds herself in Boaz's field when there were so many fields to be gleaned at? Because God orchestrated it. May the Lord order your steps in the name of Jesus. May the Lord make sure that you find your Boaz, the one who gives you that connection to your next level in the name of Jesus. You want to receive it wherever you are. The Bible says, as it turned out, Ruth, and when she came back to give the account to Naomi, Naomi said, oh, that one, yeah, he's a relative. He's a kinsman. So go ahead and do this and do that and do that. That's your portion. We want to receive that. Bear fruit. Because if we don't bear fruit, we were going to be cut down. That's what the Bible's telling us. The reason why the Lord Jesus talks about it, he says that if we don't bear, a good tree cannot bear, and he says this in verse 19, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. God is telling you and I, this is my will, that you be productive. This is my will, that whatever I give you multiplies. This is my will, that you think about other people. My will is that your gifting is used to benefit everything. The Bible says the gift of prophecy, the prophetic gift is for what? It says for the edification of the church. That's what a prophetic gift is there, for the church to increase, for the church to know direction, for the church to know how to overtake, for the church to make an impact. The gift of prophecy is not so that you can find that lotto numbers. Not so that you can find that your passport number. It's not for your own self, so that you can work out how to live your life. That bit is jara, is bonus. If you speak on behalf of God and prophesy into situations, into the church situation, God also will speak on your behalf. He will give you direction. That's a bonus. The Bible says, have you ever heard of somebody who plants a vineyard and then he's planting corn and he doesn't have corn to eat? Or he's a fish farmer and he doesn't have any fish. And his wife says, I've got to go to the market to buy fish. Does that make sense to you? The farmer will eat by his fruit, yeah? Whatever it is, if he's planting corn, he will have lots of corn. Corn in every different format. Corn to eat like that. Corn kneaded in bread, in fried. I'm sure all his children will be thinking, oh God, please. I'm waiting for the day where I don't have to eat this. In porridge, in banku, in every way. Because he's working the land, and that's what he's doing. Hello? Have you ever heard of a hairdresser who's got their shampoo and everything and then going out to buy shampoo? The shampoo is there. They'll take, right? You wash your hair. That's why if you go to a hairdresser, hairdresser's hair is no good. Don't do it. Keep it going, hairdressers. You have to look at the hairdresser and say, Or they say the hairdressers don't have time to do their hair. You have to look at them and say, yeah. That's a good hairdresser. Or you've gone to some fashion designer and the person's looking all tatty and is coming to tell you, come and buy. You know, they have to look the part. Amen. By the fruit, it's very important that we bear fruit. Otherwise, we're going to get cut down. But not only do we get cut down, but we get thrown into the fire. It's God's will that we be productive. I pray for each one of us that whatever we put our hands to do, it does prosper. Amen. Verse 21, and then we'll pray. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Now, this is what scares me. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. You know, there's a parable that talks about the farmer that's sowing, you know, and he's got the wheat and the tares, you see? And he talks about the wheat and the tares, and he says that he allows the wheat and the tares to grow together. But at harvest time, he comes in and he takes both of them, because if he does it prematurely, the crop is going to suffer. So he, even though the farmer knows that this is tares, this is rubbish, he allows it to grow. Now, many cases, just because God hasn't spoken does not mean that he's not God. Just because God hasn't said anything. You know, the Bible says that our conscience gets seared with a hot iron. If we do something continuously, they say that if you do something for 21 days in a row, it becomes a habit. That's what they say. So if you want to lead a fasted life, fast for 21 days. 21 days is coming up soon. Amen. It'll become a habit for each one of us after we finish our 21 days. But if you do something continuing for 21 days, the psychologists say it becomes a habit. So when something becomes a habit, habits are very difficult to break, right? That's why somebody sings a song, "Your hard habit to break." A habit is difficult to break. And that is why we must train ourselves to have good habits. Good habits, habits that we don't need to break. But God is telling you and I that just because sometimes we operate in some ways, God is not deaf. Hello? Neither is he dumb. Neither is he blind. He says in Isaiah, he says, my hand is not short that I cannot reach you. It's just that sometimes God gives us, and I love it when Pastor says, he said God gives us a long rope. So what he does is he ties, just like if you've got a sheep, a cow, whatever, you can tie that thing with a very long rope and tie it this way. And so what God is giving us is an opportunity for you and I to repent. That is why we have the word of God. That is why every Sunday we have the opportunity, every day we have the opportunity to hear the word of God, so that our hearts might be changed. So God is not hanging us. Well, the hanging will come, but it depends on you and I. Amen. So that he's giving us that long rope. Yeah, so that when it comes to the hanging, you yourself will hang yourself, just like Haman did. Haman literally hanged himself because he set Esther up, so the Jews up, so that they can hang, or Mordecai, so that it can be hanged. He built his own guillotine. He did all of that. Some of us, God forbid, let it not be so in this house, we're digging our own graves. You know, there's a statement like that, digging your own grave. And so you're digging the grave. The grave digger digs for somebody else to lie in it. But you're digging it. When you finish, you put your own self in it. God forbid. He says, it's not everybody that calls on Lord, Lord, who will come into the kingdom. That means to tell me that I was wondering to myself, God, what's going on there? What does that mean? And then I was reminded about scripture. This is another scripture that scares me. When God instructed Saul to go to war, he instructed him through the prophet Samuel. Go do this, go do that, go do that. When you get there, kill these people. Don't spare anybody and all of that. We know the scriptures in 1 Samuel 15. Write it down when you go home. Read it. Now, when Samuel got to Saul, he said, Samuel said something. He said, the Lord bless you. I have carried out the Lord's instructions. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of sheep in my ears? What is the lowing of cattle that I hear? Because God had given instruction, kill everybody, don't spare any animal, nothing, nothing. And Saul, you would say to yourself, how odd. Why would Saul, knowing full well that he had not obeyed God, say that? But he says to Samuel, he receives him with joy and enthusiasm and enthusiastically says, the Lord bless you, prophet. I have carried out, he says, I have carried out the Lord's instructions. As far as Saul was concerned, he carried out the Lord's instructions. Now, this is the thing. Either he was being deceitful, or either he genuinely thought that he had carried out the instructions. cannot tell. But look at this. The Bible said that when he was queried, he said that because the men, forced him to make him make that decision. But God had given him instructions. Would we, in many cases, we realize that we get led astray because we want to please our friend. But what did God say? We want to please our husband, our wife. But what did God say? There's a man of God that came here one day, and he was talking to myself and Pastor Adum about something. And he just turns to us and he said, look, when the Lord called you and I, nobody else was there. So if we said that God has called us, let's just get on and do the work. I mean, I laughed so much, but I would never forgotten it because it was so funny. We were talking about something, I've forgotten something. He said, look, when the Lord called you, I was not there. They were not there. And when God called you and I, anytime God has an encounter, God comes to meet somebody. And look in scripture. There's an encounter. It's always God and that person. Even when there are other people, like Paul, Saul at that time, on the way road to Damascus. Or is it Saul? Somebody, anyway. I can't remember. But that particular person, as he had an encounter, the people saw or whatever, but they did not hear. Is it him? Yeah, it's him. But because the instruction was just for him. So though they felt the effect of it, they did not hear because God had come to speak to Paul, even though he was in the midst of the people. So we could be in the midst of worship. We could be there, but God is speaking to you and you and you and you on an individual basis. I'm not there. So it's important that we follow the instructions that God has called us and let's not get astray. Because then that way God's will is met. Amen. Otherwise, we lose the kingdom. Because what happened with Saul is that, but Samuel replied, does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. We're talking about the will of God. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father. The will of God is important. And most importantly, we want to thank God for instructions. Because if we, you know, many a time we're asking God, speak to me. If you don't speak, I can't go. If you don't speak, we're asking God. But we thank God that he does speak. But when he does speak, what do we do with the instructions? And so as we close today, we want to pray. We're still talking about God's will. God's will is that when he speaks to us, that we fully obey the instructions that he's given to us. When the disciples were brought together in the upper room, Jesus didn't tell them anything. He just said to them, wait. He says, just wait. Wait until they didn't know what's the Holy Spirit. What's he talking about? They had no clue. All they knew is that God had told them to wait. And so they did what? They waited. And when the Holy Spirit came, they realized it's time to move. They followed the instructions. And out of that obedience, you and I are blessed today. You and I are carrying that obedience that they gave them. And so we want to pray to God that, God, your will is that I may obey you. When all is said and done, no matter what preaching you hear, no matter what word you hear, it's all about obedience. Because if we don't obey it, there's no point. Because a time will come, the scary time will come, when the wheat and the tares have grown together, and then God comes and says, sorry. I don't know you, just like the scripture said, but I prophesied in your name. People are coming to the Lord, but you became a signpost. Sometimes it's quite scary that maybe, you look at me, you might think to yourself, oh, Mama Dodd, she's so powerful, she's very spiritual, she's this, that. But actually, I could be living in disobedience to God. Because you're not there when God spoke to me. So God may tell me, do this, do that. So the gift of God that God gives is without repentance. I can go ahead and still preach, all right? I can go ahead and still prophesy and be a blessing. But actually, in my own life, do you understand? I'm not living in obedience to God. And the time will come and say, I'm not pleased with you. So it's very important that we check our hearts. It's very important that we look to God and give ourselves to God so that his will on earth might be done. You want to rise as we bring our service to a close. You heard the word of God. The word of God is for each one of us. And I know that God always gives us always watches over his word to bring about a performance. You want to pray into this word and say, Lord, here's my heart. I pray, Father, that I will be able to at all times be obedient, that I'll be vigilant. The Bible says we should be watchful, we should be sober for the...